One of the things that I always try and do is look at me first. I think a lot of times we try and fix the team and fix an attitude and fix a problem and whatever. This is the team that I lead, and we're not in the direction or going the direction I want us to go. I'm pointing the finger at myself first.
Welcome to the Jamoti Podcast. We are all surrounded by amazing coaches and leaders. So let's get an inside look at not just what they do, but how they do what they do. After all, becoming the best versions of ourselves is Jamoti, just a matter of doing it.
Today, we're joined by the head men's basketball coach at Emmanuel College, TJ Rosine. In 22 years of coaching, Coach Rosine has led his team to 3 NCCAA national championships and 12 20-plus win seasons. He is a 2-time National Coach of the Year, as well as an 8-time Conference Coach of the Year. Coach Rosine is the Director of Coaches Development for PGC. He's also the co-host of the well-known basketball podcast, The Hardwood Hustle. Before we hear from Coach, take a moment to subscribe to our podcast and follow us on social media at Jamoti Podcast.
I just want to thank you for giving up your time. I mean, I've had the pleasure of knowing you for, I don't know, a decade now, maybe around there. And I don't know if you know this, but I think a lot of people look at you as a coach's coach, you know, somebody that we learn from and we watch, and we're just, that always inspires us. So the fact that you're so busy and you would give up your time like this for me is just incredible.
Man, excited. Always love spending time with a good friend like you.
I've always seen you as somebody that, even with PGC, they just have amazing connections, relationships with, I mean, it could be basket directors or other directors, but then even with your own team, with your players. How and when do you meet with players and really help build that bond?
Yeah, you know, I think that's really interesting because we're in the relationship business no matter what. I mean, it doesn't matter what level you coach at. If you don't have good relationships, if you don't have good communication, it's really hard, you know, to get a team to thrive, to get players to reach their potential. And so you have to be really intentional about this. And, you know, I think there's the art of coaching and kind of the science of coaching. And I think meeting with players and connecting with players is a little bit of both. And, you know, the science of it is this, is that you need to do it. You need to schedule it in. And I tell people this all the time that this was really big for me in my coaching, was scheduling in a lot of these meetings, because I'm a high D personality and I'm thinking about what's next. What do you do? What do you know? How do I get this accomplished? And it really started out really simple for me, is I put 2 to 3 names on my practice plan, and I made sure that I grabbed them before or after practice and said, how's life? How's school? You know, what's going on? And truthfully, it was awkward for me in the beginning, because I was like, oh man, you know, I'm thinking about how we need to fix this in our zone, or I'm thinking about how we, but I also knew I wanted to be a transformational coach. I wanted to reach people's lives. So I knew that relationships and connections were really important. And over the years, we've done a lot of different things for player meetings. And I think some of it depends on, you know, the leadership of your team, because we have our team actually good. When we have a really strong leadership, we have our leaders meet with other players on the team.
Nice.
We also have, where like Graham Maxwell is a phenomenal assistant, and I've had him associate head coach, where there's a lot of meetings he does with the players that might be outside of things that I might talk to them about. So we're not trying to kill them with player meetings, but we are trying to smother them with touches. How do they actually meet with a captain? How do they spend time with Graham? How do they spend time with me? And we, over the years, we've adjusted that. One of my favorite ones is probably like 7-minute tune-ups, where once a week we meet with everybody for 7 minutes. And in those conversations, we just kind of had a series of questions about, you know, what's going on in life? How's school going? How you feeling about your game? Now, in those 7-minute tune-ups, some guys were like, man, it's all good. Like, life's great. I'm doing it right.
It's a 2-minute tune-up.
Yeah, really. And that's all they needed. But also in those tune-ups, sometimes we got responses that said, you know what? We need to meet with this player longer. There's more going on. And so, you know, there's 12 players and 10 of them, you know, take 7-minute tune-up and you're good to go. We checked in, life's good. But there's 2 of them that you could tell, man, by their answers, there's something going on. Hey, why don't you come by the office this afternoon for 30 minutes to an hour or whatever it might be? So really just kind of being like a doctor, like, you know, this person's healthy, you know, they don't need much. This person is not doing so good, and they need some, some more, you know, in-depth prescription here of time or other people or other resources to talk to, but it really gave us a gauge of where, how our players were doing and where we might need to go next with the next meeting.
Man, I'm so glad that I got to do this with you, because that's one of those questions, one of those areas where I really feel like I fall short, focused on basketball, focused on skill development and all of the, you know, shooting, whatever. But then sometimes lacking in relationships. And I wonder how many times do I think I know the pulse, or I have a good sense of really where the team's at or where an individual's at, but man, I might just be completely off. And those nuggets right there, I would imagine that throughout the season, you would be somebody, like you said, the art of it, having a good idea of what the pulse of your team is, where they need to go. I feel like you probably have that down.
You know, not perfect, but I care about it, and I want to do it well because I want to impact young people. And, you know, one of the things that we've done in the past too that I really think helps is like the 5 love languages test. You can just kind of print that off and people can take it. And you recognize, like, I've got a player, really, really good player, going to be a pro, first team All-American, you know, but his love language is quality time. And so I recognize that I need to spend time with him, right? And then I have another player from the great state of Texas, where you're at, really a different personality. And honestly, it's like our 7-minute, you know, tune-ups are like 90 seconds. He's like just one of those guys that's like, you know, and he'll see me once a semester or whatever, maybe have to talk about something, but he's not a quality time guy. He's more just like, hey, I know you love me. I know you that you care about me. We're good. Like, let's
but
just
knowing that work. Knowing that is huge.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And because if you could miss that, it's the same thing in marriage. You know, like you give love the way you receive it. I'm acts of service. So I say this all the time. Like, I don't mind cleaning the house, washing the dishes, going to get the groceries and doing everything under the sun for my wife. But that doesn't make her feel loved. And it's the same thing with players, you know, so she's words of affirmation. So I could do 4 hours of acts of service, and that wouldn't equate to 30 seconds of "you look beautiful today," you know, just a compliment. And we can miss, just like we miss in our own relationships, we can miss with our players too.
That's good. Have you always been that intentional about those relationships with your players? Or, like, I think sometimes starting out in coaching, we might teeter on one side or the other, heavy X's and O's, like you talked about earlier, or heavy art and relationships. What side did you start out as?
Yeah, well, I'm a high D on the disc personality, like a driver. And so my natural, and I think a lot of coaches, you know, have that, not everybody, but a lot of coaches are thinking about how to get the right offense and how to get the right defense and get your players going, all that kind of stuff. But I also have a heart to be a transformational coach, and that's my end game of winning. And there's no shortcutting that. You have to invest in people. And so it was a mix for me, to be honest with you. Like, I think early in my career, I was probably, you know, my time was just organic. And so I would be like, yeah, if a player needs me, let's go eat lunch. Let's go spend time. And I was willing to do that. But as I've grown as a coach, I've realized that oftentimes those only happened when it became overbearing, too much. And I wanted to catch it before that. I wanted to help them along the journey. And as coaches, we're crazy busy, right? And so if you don't schedule it, it typically doesn't get done. And so that's where, you know, I've become more intentional about trying to make sure we're scheduling in the relationship time, the meeting time, time to transform, time to pour in, you know, all of those things, because it's better for me. It's better for my schedule. I still got a wife and kids and a whole bunch of other things going on in my life, just like you do and every other coach on here does. And so we have to protect our time. And if we want to give them our best, it's hard to do it just organically and be like, oh yeah, let me just take 2 hours and miss my kid's soccer game or miss my, it's tough. And so you got to schedule well. And I had to learn to do that.
Man, that's such a great nugget, because you're right on the money. Majority of times I feel like where we intentionally meet with players, it's because there's already a problem. Yeah. Something is brewing and now we have to come. But I mean, that doesn't work in any area of life. Like, take our fitness or our health. Oh, the doctor says I may have a heart attack. Like, it's a bad place to be. You have to do the work early on. So thank you for that reminder there.
Absolutely.
Coaches, the Jamoti podcast is powered by Ballogy. What's your BSA score? The Ballogy Skills Assessment is the only verified skills metric endorsed by the NAIA, NJCAA, and a growing number of NCAA coaches to discover and develop the best talent for your team. This 4-minute, 40-shot test can be taken free today on the Ballogy mobile app. Elevate your game. With your team, there's a kind of a debate, I feel like, out there sometimes of analytics and how much they do matter, how much you put time you pour into them. And then, you know, there's another tribe of, I really don't spend any time looking at that, and we're just going to do what we do. I'm going to focus on our guys or whatever. How do analytics, what role do they play with your program?
You know, I think it's an interesting debate, right? Because analytics definitely affect the game. And I think at all levels, coaches should have some awareness of them. Now, how much you use them, they impact you. Like, there's a lot of things that go into that. Like, what resources do you have? How much of your time can you put to that with analytics? And like, I'd say where we're at, we're in between, right? Like, we're not able to use NBA analytics where it's in depth on everything that we're doing. But at the same time, you know, it's not necessarily middle school where I don't have any resources. I'm the only coach out there. Like, we're
just paper and pad, man. That's all I got.
Yeah. And so I get that, but I think there are some simple things you can do in analytics that can make a difference. But I also really believe it's what you emphasize and what you really care about. And so, you know, analytics only are going to help you if it's going to help drive your team in a direction, or it's just going to provide awareness for you or scouting of your opponent. But I think you have to be super intentional on how you're going to use those. And for us, that typically means this: picking two or three things analytically that will help drive us to our goals offensively or defensively. And so, like, what are those things? Like, field goal efficiency, you know, like, that's a pretty common one that I think most coaches understand. If you research for 30 minutes, you can understand what it is. And it's relatable to the players. Like, that's something they can take in and they can get it. There's other things that I don't think players, you know, always understand. Another analytics that I've always liked is how teams perform together, you know, like what groups of players, you know, actually work well together. And, you know, in college, there's things you can buy that help you to do that. But we've also done that without having the resources of just going back and watching film and saying this group was up 4, up 10. Then after 10 games, we think, man, this kind of affirms what I've been seeing in practice. This group plays well together. This player actually makes these things. A lot of times what that equates to is in practice is who's winning. Who's winning the 3-on-3, who's winning the 4-on-4, you know, and there's usually a correlation between those types of things. But, you know, I think those are two that I like, because I like to know who plays well together. And I think effective field goal percentage is really important for players to realize how effective they actually are. You know, and there's other analytic things that we might use on defense or rebounding, just sometimes just simple. Like, you know, rebounding can be one of the most misleading stats out there if you don't really understand how it works. And so it's, you know, just because your team, Matt, gets 10 offensive rebounds and mine gets 5. Well, there's a ton of factors. You didn't just beat me by 5 offensive rebounds. I mean, what if you shot 70% from the field and I shot 40? So there's so many things. So yeah. I think, you know, is there a simple stat that will help an analytic that will help your rebounding or guide you towards that? Is there a simple stat that will help you defensively? Is there a simple stat that will help you offensively? I think if for most of us, you know, that aren't in the NBA or you know, a Power 5, I think we could narrow it down to 2 or 3 analytics that will really, really help us drive to success.
And a key, like you said, is choosing things that your players care about. Because you look at a huddle breakdown and it, you know, it's 4 pages and, you know, we could look through it and we find so many interesting things, but our players, when we start to read off the page, will glaze over and we lose them. But we can also use, I love what you said. I think analytics, they're important and they're there, and to ignore them, I don't know if that's wise. But we have to figure out what leads to winning. And then what you said with EFGs, but then also the groups that play well, analytics can also help with role identification, playing time, and helping players understand a little bit more about the decisions you make.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, because there's a lot of analytics that can help a player understand whether they're doing well or not doing well. And I liken it to like a math teacher. Like, you know, you might be the smartest math teacher on earth and you might understand all of these analytics, but if you can't get the learner to actually use that, apply that, understand it, like what use is it? And so like a term that I like is applied analytics. Like what can you actually apply? Because analytics in itself is overwhelming to people. And when you think about a coach with all the jobs they've got going on, the things that it can be really, or it can be the opposite. You dive way into these analytics. You're a genius at what you're doing, but no one understands why you're using it, how you're using it. It doesn't affect players' performance. It doesn't help them to realize, you know, what their role is. Anything analytically that you can really apply to improve your team, I would use it. I mean, I think it's really good stuff. Where the problem is really the application part of it. And how do I attach meaning to it, to the learner or to my player?
And do the analytics that you're focusing on, do they actually fit your style of play?
Yeah.
Because if you're not focusing on things that really you're not working on in practice or emphasizing in gameplay, I just wonder how much time might be wasted, because we are talking about things that are good and the stats are there that for you to see, but don't necessarily equate to winning.
Yeah, you know, one of the things my dad used to do this. My dad was a longtime high school coach, and man, he used to do his own analytics. You know, I mean, he would just sit. You know, at 65 years old, he would just sit in his recliner, watch my team play, and he just kind of made up his own stuff. But one he did that I think you can find is really, it's like, you know, points per 40 minutes is a pretty interesting one to look at your team, because we play 40, a high school game, 32. But there's many times that he handed that to me and I realized, gosh, this player would actually be averaging this if they got that amount of clock, or this player would actually be. And most of the time, for whatever reason, I don't have any science behind it, but that stat often equated to me not playing somebody enough. Wow. They were a better scorer than I thought, and they weren't getting into the rhythm in the game. But when they did get that opportunity, and I can think probably one or two players every single year that I might have been off on their playing time, that I just gave them a little more based on that stat my dad gave me, and it, you know, played out pretty well. Like the more they got their opportunities, even the more of the rhythm they got in there, the more of the effective scorer they became for us.
Is that something you would recommend that coaches do, look back over, look at some games, and especially for your returning players? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's a good one for this reason. I think as coaches, I mean, we all have favorite players, whether people want to admit it or not. You know, we all have favorites, and oftentimes, you know, oftentimes for good reason, our favorites are the hardest workers. They're, you know, the best teammate. So we have those favorites, but we can also get some of that bias to get in our way of like, man, we know so-and-so is the best player and can score a lot, but we let them roll for the whole 30 minutes or 32 minutes. And then they become a volume guy where there's other people that are more efficient. And what would it be like if I sat this guy and played this guy a little bit more? Like, you know, there's probably, and there's not a lot to be honest with you, but there's probably one guy on your roster, maybe two girls on your roster that you look at and you say, you know, gosh, their points per minute would have been third on our team, but they've got the ninth most playing time. Like, I wonder if this is something I should look into. And typically that's what I found. Each year I was missing on one guy that needed to be playing more. And I think it's helpful. Once I got him in the rotation, it was really helpful for us.
Yeah, so it sounds like a good combination of, you know, you've got the money ball strategy. Love that movie, but it's just, we're just going to go by the numbers. And yeah. Even with shooting twos versus shooting threes, mid-range, we're just going to but then there's the art side of it too, like you're talking about. It's really finding a balance between those will be helpful, right?
Yeah, and you know, another one my dad gave me that I thought was really good, and I'm sure this is elsewhere in analytics as well, and I don't know how he spent time doing this, but he compared my top three or four players and the amount of time they were on the floor to everybody else comparative in the league. And what I found out, like, it was a thing in my coaching. Like, I think as a young coach, like, man, I just really wanted everybody to play. I wanted everybody to get opportunity. They were putting in so much work. And my dad would just pound it into me, your best players are not on the floor enough. And I was just like, oh my gosh, you know, and it really did have me trim down my roster, where I realized that, you know, that 5 or 6 minutes, the player number 10 was actually decreasing my number one player's time 5 or 6 minutes. And then I realized my best player was on the court 23 minutes, but their best player was on the court 30 minutes. And it really challenged me as a coach to think, gosh, am I just being too nice? Am I not really actually playing the best players? And I do think I was. And I, yeah, you know, and I think it helped us. And particularly early in the season, we were an average team and we would always finish strong. And I think subconsciously, I was getting more of my better players, more playing time, but it actually hurt us early in the year because I wasn't kind of narrowing that down a little bit. And so that's another one that I thought really helped me as a coach. I don't use it as much now because I feel like I've changed that as a coach, but it was actually a kind of a systematic change because I saw the analytics there.
Being so transformational like you are and valuing those relationships, you know, how do you keep if you're going to shorten that rotation and you're going to focus on, which should be the focus, especially the 40 minutes that we get, the 32 minutes, focus on winning, you know, during that time, how do you continue to build up guys? I mean, I guess it goes back to the original question of that we started with building relationships, but how do you keep those? Because I felt that the years where I played a lot of dudes, and you and I have talked about that over time, it just never ended well. It really did it. And I was hurting them. I was hurting the best players. I was hurting our team. And then I've shortened it, kept best players on the floor longer, and it has led to more winning. How do you balance that, though, and still build those other guys up?
You know, I love conflict and adversity just because I feel like good things come from it. And so, you know, I've shared this before, but I try most days to have a courageous conversation, like one that's hard, like one that most people just don't want to have. And I feel like it's helped me as a coach. I really feel like it's helped a lot of young people. And, you know, one way that we've been really intentional to do that, like in those meetings and discussing with players, is discuss it before it ever happens. You know, like I think everybody goes in the season thinking they're going to play the full game or they're going to average 10 points or they're going to go. We have the first week of our team meetings, we talk about all the things that could go wrong and what we're going to do when it goes wrong. And playing time is always one of them. And that's just a big team meeting. But then there's also individual meetings where I had one with a player who, you know, I didn't know if they were going to be, you know, a guy that was on the varsity, if they were going to play for our team, if they're going to be in our program, whatever. And before it ever happened, I said, listen, here's the reality. There is a high likelihood that you will never get in the game and you're going to have to be a phenomenal teammate. And I said, this is a super hard job, a really, really hard job. I don't know if I would want this job, but here's what can't happen. We cannot go into the season and 4 weeks in or 14 weeks in, we're having to spend a lot of time because you're unhappy. And so we've got to make a decision now, like before this ever becomes a problem, we've got to figure, is it best for you to whatever, just go play JV and get up more shots? Is it best for you to maybe not even play basketball anymore? You know, it's been, yeah. Now listen, when you're on the team, you're going to have an opportunity every single day to prove it. And I want to help you become a better player. And I want to see you become the best you can be. But I also need to be truthful where you stand right now. And I look, that player was like, absolutely, I want to get on that bus and stay in those hotels and I want the gear and I wanted, you know, they wanted all the stuff that went to be a part of the team. And we're about, you know, 8-10 weeks in, this happens every year. And they're like, coach, you know, I think I need a little bit more of a shot. And I would stop that player and I'd say, listen, I'm going to go back to August 17th when we had this discussion. And I knew this was coming. I knew this was going to be hard on you. And I'm doing the best I can for the team to make the right decisions. And I stand behind like what my decision is now. Now you have a big decision to make. Can you go back to being a phenomenal teammate? Because the bench ends where people stop adding value. And if you're going to take away any value because of lack of effort, bad attitude, the bench has to end right there. And so if I haven't had that conversation with him prior, that conversation sounds like I'm just a jerk.
Yeah.
But because I've had the previous one, Listen, we've been there. I know this was coming. And when you can call it out before it ever happens, they look at you like, man, who is this guy? You already knew this was going to happen. Like, you know, and we know because we've been coaching long. We know this kind of stuff's going to happen. But for them, look, they told me, they warned me. It was fair warning. And so I think preemptive conversations, I think courageous conversations, I think constant communication, I think truth, love, and transparency in the way you're talking to young people, all of those things, I think help in those situations.
And it'll definitely help keeping those connections beyond basketball, because they'll look back at those moments, and as much as they hated it and it wasn't what they wanted to hear, the fact that you told them the truth, which, you know, I think we just battle this all the time, maybe within ourselves, of wanting to please or to get the player excited, to maybe inject him with some more energy and focus to train harder if we say he can achieve these things. And then sometimes I feel like we're wrestling as at a high school, you know, maybe with other sports even, where you get the feeling like they're just being told all the good stuff. And then here I am, the lone truth teller. And any encouragement for guys that might feel like that at times?
You know, I think it goes back to like just being a transformational coach. I read this the other day, but I'm not sure what these people or young kids need right now is more friends. They need more mentors, and mentors and people that care about them are going to be the truth tellers. And, you know, I start a lot of those conversations like, hey, listen, I appreciate you coming to talk about this, and you know how much I love you. But look, I got to go back to that August 17 conversation, you know, like, and so you don't have, I think a lot of the way you frame these things is really helpful. Like, if it's in love, it's in help, if it's in, right, you know, all those types of things. But inevitably, you're still going to have young people that if you don't tell them what they want to hear, they're not going to be a fan. They're going to walk away. They're going to do whatever, you know. But that's becoming, you know, a responsible adult. You're going to have to make tough decisions. You're going to have to hear tough things. And I honestly think it's a real injustice to go the other way with it. And do all that other stuff where we're just kind of building them up and then just so they fall flat, or we're just, you know, look, I don't think you need to kill a kid's spirit, but I think you need to tell them the truth. You know, like, I think you need to the opportunities, like, look, if you were to be, you know, get in 5 minutes a game, I think that would be phenomenal for you. Now you're free to surpass that and play 10 minutes a game, but I'm gonna be honest, right now I see you at zero. I think it's a possibility that you could work to maybe five, but I think that'll be a real long shot. But I'm rooting for you and I'm pulling for you. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, I'm in your corner, but you got to tell them the truth. As a college coach, my assistants, I don't think they can stand how many recruits we lose because I tell them the truth. I mean, I think it's just, it's got to be.
They want you to hold back just a little bit.
Just a little bit. And I paint the worst case scenario. You know, like, look, I'm not promising you nothing. And I think the Lord's provided the right players for us. And we've been faithful in the way that we've done things. You know, I've always said you can't out recruit the Lord. The right people are going to be here. And that's all that we want, is the right people to be here. But I know from like a worldly view, like, it could be really frustrating to work with me or through in recruiting process, because I just really err on the side of truth.
Yeah. And trusting, like you just mentioned, trusting that God will put the right people on the bus. But then, and then by having those tough conversations too, you probably eliminate so many situations that would steal your joy. Like, we can't let players steal our joy. And part of that is helping them know early on, like, what are some things that could take joy away from what we're doing as a team, or even you as a coach. And you're probably sidestepping tons of landmines with players by, if they react poorly to the truth, like, that's telling you something.
Yeah. I mean, I can't tell you how many times I've told the truth on a player that I was like, I really want this player. But their reaction to the truth told me, wait a second, I really didn't want this player. You know, this would have gone bad, or this would have gone poorly. And, you know, it's just, you can't sweep that stuff under the rug. We've all done this long enough to know what happens when you just keep sweeping hard conversations and all that kind of stuff under the rug. At some point, it just doesn't get pretty.
The Jamoti Podcast is powered by Sideline Interactive. Sideline Interactive is the leading manufacturer for high-quality, innovative scoring tables and LED video display boards that help coaches and schools bring more excitement to fans, create huge fundraising opportunities, and make their jobs easier. Visit sidelineinteractive.com to check out their amazing products.
Another argument that's out there, or just there, where there's great conversations, is there's guys out there, I've been guilty of it in the past, of we have a system of play, and I don't care who you are, I can bring you in, and you can fit into this system and flourish, and we can go, and it doesn't have to change from year to year. There's other coaches that sometimes I envy in a way of they have the ability to, I can coach anything, and as long as it helps this group of players, you know, contribute to winning, that's what we'll go with. Where do you line up on that with your program?
Know yourself, know your situation. I think that's the most important thing. I mean, I've got, you know, really my goals are simple, is to tap them out and their abilities as people, and to tap out the team and their abilities that they can maximize to get where they need to get. And so I will do whatever I have to do that. But there is a point of diminished return, you know, like if Flex was going to get them as far as they could possibly go, but I really don't teach Flex well, I don't really understand Flex well, I don't really what it like, you know, there's a little bit of a rub there. Now, look, if I'm great at Flex, I'm great at read and react, I'm great at dribble drive, I'm great at all those things, then just pick the one that fits the team the best. But if you're not great at all those things, it doesn't fit your personality, and you're not great at teaching it, then you have to do something that you teach well. Like, what's the thing that I teach the best that could actually help this team the most? I think the answer also oftentimes lies in this. How can I tweak what I teach the best to fit this team? You know, like if I love this particular style of play, but I recognize that I need to adjust a few things based on personnel, that's the route I would typically want to go. But I think knowing yourself, I think also knowing the situation, you know, like I can't tell you how many coaches I've seen that they have a particular type of player, and then the next couple of years, it's a different type of player, you know. And look, for us, you know, I like having a system, but I also recognize that we're in between. Like, we don't have the best facility, the most money. Like, we lose a lot of recruiting battles. And so I'm not going to be able to just pick and choose. And so if I'm picking the eighth best post player in my league and the fourth best guard and whatever, and but I'm running the same stuff the first team, it's get all the best players runs, I'm probably going up. And I've said that a lot of times. Like, you got to sometimes be a curveball in a fastball league. You know, you can't always, you know, if you go into the SEC and you try and do it exactly how Kentucky does it and their players are better than yours,
yeah.
You're just going to be hitting your head against the wall.
Man, it goes back to what you've said before about the art of it, right? Like, because you can pretty much, any of these gurus that are out there that have their style that they're, you know, selling or trying to teach, and there's some great ones, it'll sound so good. But if you don't know how exactly it'll fit with your guys, with your personnel, or in your league, like you said, will it contribute to winning? You got to make that decision ultimately.
Yeah, and it's a hard decision. I mean, there's no absolutes, you know what I mean? Like, there's no way, and I think as much as anything, it's navigating the season a little bit. Like, I see some teams come in and they've got their offense down to a science. They run it perfect. They're good, but they kind of just flutter out as the season goes on, as people adjust, whatever. And then there's other people that come in that they just got to have them make a lot of adjustments as the year goes on. There's just no one way to skin a cat. And I think you're just constantly in pursuit of, like, what are the little things that can help my team run better offense, better defense, better transition, whatever it is that I think is going to help you get over the hump or make you 1% better that day.
I need your advice on this, because it's something that my previous job was at McKinney High School, and I was a varsity assistant for Wes Watson. They just had an incredible year down here in Texas, and we went through, we had discovered, it was kind of tell you the time frame, but dribble drive with Memphis and Calipari was really becoming big. And so we looked at our group that we had, and we really wanted to go with that. We really had one player that we thought could start that wheel. It would just be really hard to stop, and some shooters around. And we started that year off all dribble drive. That was our focus. That was our path. And this kid was at a party, got caught doing some things, and the UIL policy was half of his senior year gone. Mm. Like it was that level. And so here we are with this plan, but the guy that we wanted to make the whole thing work is gone. Yeah. And we completely scrapped that and went to another motion offense. And we were 8-21. It was a disaster. We were upset. They were upset. And we kind of made, we were always wondering, like, should we have stuck with that plan, even though we felt like, you know, it, or scrap it like we did? What's your advice to coaches that may be in that position?
Well, if they're not in that position, they're going to be in that position. I mean, it happens all of the time. Even when you have the right personnel, you go in and you think this particular thing. And, you know, sometimes we have an off season to think so much that we adjust so much and we change and we've got all these things we want to figure out. And I think the old Don Meyer, like simple, sound and solid, like how could I get a team? To answer your question specifically, you know, I've talked about this a lot, like in Read and React, player movement, ball movement, and spacing, like those three things. And so now you can make that happen in just about any offense, like you make it happen well, but a lot of offenses are geared more towards something. And, you know, I think that if that wheel doesn't get turning, the dribble drive spacing is great, but the ball movement and player movement, if it doesn't get turning, can be pretty stagnant. And so then it becomes a bit of a problem. And so, I mean, the long and short answer is this, like I like choosing offense that allows players to develop, you know what I mean? That gives players opportunities to get better throughout. The second thing is I look at offense like this. Eventually it's going to break down to you're going to be playing something where players got to make plays. So it's going to be in the dribble drive, you know, guy gets into the paint, you know, we're read and react, a guy catches the ball off of cuts. Eventually they're just playing basketball, right? And so what is it we're going to flow into? The tough thing, or the thing that you have to figure out, and I think you had a good analogy, how do you get the wheel started? Like, and if you only have one way to get the wheel started, and that's the only solution. Like, so in that particular scenario, I don't know that this was the right answer, but even with my best player out there, I would have been thinking about ways to get the wheel turning without him or from other players. No matter what offense you're in, because it really is this simple, like what is going to get the ball in the paint for us?
Yeah.
You know, what's going to get it there? Because when it gets there, we're dropping, we're finishing, we're kicking. Like one of those stuff's happening, but we're doing that in transition. We're doing that in read and react. We're doing that in dribble drive. We're doing whatever. But if you can't ever get into the paint, no matter what offense it is, and you're just playing windshield wipers around the perimeter, then that. So I think really the problem lies in how do we actually get the wheel turning, or how do we get the ball in the paint?
Yeah, that's a great point. Like what if any offense that you choose to run, you basically have the same concepts behind it. Guys, in this offense, we're going to create an advantage on this movement. Once that advantage is created, here are the concepts that you have to be able to do and see, you know, are we going to cash in or are we going to transfer and off of that? But you're right on the money. Like, I think where we missed the boat was, you know, dribble drive has, which I had a coach down here, Tommy Brackle at North Crowley, had something really cool. I asked, he was a dribble drive king down here. I asked him, are you still doing that? And because it was about 15, 20 years later, he said, you know, we run some other stuff and we have some sets that we might, some actions we might have to get into things, but dribble drive is always the offense behind our offense.
Yeah.
I mean, it's always the concepts that we are still falling into because you nailed it. I mean, watch any level of basketball. Sometimes the plays work. Sometimes you catch them off balance. There's a bad switch, lack of communication. But defenses are good. High level college basketball defenses are good. It's going to come down to creating plays off of an advantage.
Yeah, and that's that. When you're creating your offense, where can we get our advantages? You know, I mean, and really, it's how do you play inside out basketball? How does it get down there? So, like dribble drive, if you can't get the wheel started, can you throw it into the post more? If you can't get it in there, can you get it in there off some sort of ball screen or false action? Can you get it in there? You know, like what are the ways? And I think really good offensive coaches do a good job of just creating those. I mean, look at Villanova and it kind of made the Barkley famous, right? That's another way to just play inside out basketball. And they have solutions to problems of when we can't get the ball inside, here's another option of a way to get it there, and then they get good at playing inside out.
Another danger of completely scrapping something and going to something else, besides the fact that you're, I mean, all the time that you spent, you know, I mean, maybe some of the skill work will translate or carry over. But I wonder too about, I think the confidence that your players have in the plan that you've set out or outlined before them, I think that's really important, where they need to know, like, it's not that we know everything, but that we're competent and we have a plan that we believe in and that we, like you said, we have solutions. When you scrap it, what message is that? Like, what message did we send to that 0708 team, which is, oh, he's out, the rest of you suck, we've got to do something completely different? That was awful.
Yeah, and it's tough because I imagine there's times to punt, you know what I mean, and scrap it. I mean, I imagine over the course of the season, there might be some times when you're like, guys, girls, I screwed this up. We got to change. And, you know, I don't know that that's the best solution most of the time, but there might be some scenarios. I mean, I remember as a young coach, oh my gosh, we ran every offense championship productions put out on video. Like, I'd watched every one, and I'm 23 years old and I'm trying to put in, we're changing offenses by the week. And I know that was bad for those players. I feel horrible. I want to send them an apology card every Christmas. Like, I'm so sorry that you had me as a coach, because, you know, that Don Meyer, going back to it, like, Whatever you teach, can you make it simple, sound, and solid, no matter what your offense is? And, you know, like, that's the read and react. Like, there's 20 different layers to it, and that's really complicated. But there's some coaches that can make it really simple, sound solid. I've seen some youth coaches just run level 1, 2, 3, and 4, you know, and can you just keep whatever offense you choose where they're simple, sound, solid, the players are getting better every day in it, and if there's major problems, can you find simple adjustments to it? You know, and I think it's really important for coaches that whenever system you put in, offensive, defense, when I say system, I mean just the whole systems and strategies, whatever you do that puts in, like, you want to focus on being great at your system. But I do think there needs to be built-in adjustments, things that don't change or scrap the way you play, but will benefit you in these certain situations. And I do think sometimes people can get really stubborn, and this is what we do, and, you know, that's all, no matter what, we're going to do this.
Coach, you're talking to the stubborn person. You're talking to him right now.
I think all of us have been there. I don't think the opposite of that is a full change. Like, I don't think you run, gun, do whatever, and then all of a sudden, oh, yeah, we're playing this team. Now we're walking it up and playing pack line.
Because, like, it's the confidence piece. Yeah.
Yeah, but what adjustments do we make that are subtle that allow us to get a chance in this game? And that might be just something as simple as, you know, being more choosy about trying to get 6s and 7s and whatever. Just that might be the solution to slowing it down and lowering the possessions, because I don't think less possessions or more possessions always favors the bigger, stronger athletic team. I think more possessions favors the more skilled, better team, not just athletic. And so I don't think you need to slow it down because they're bigger, faster, stronger. But at the same time, you don't want to play into what they do as far as they're, you know, bigger, faster, stronger. Therefore, we're going to take a bunch of bad shots. And now in our 60 possessions, we've got 30 bad ones because they sped us up, but they got 50 good ones because they sped us up. That's just the recipe for losing.
That's a great point, though, about the skill. I mean, yeah, it's not just because even two teams that are equal as far as athleticism goes and size, if the skill is that far off, then, yeah, you're right on the money there.
Yeah. I mean, I see a lot of D3 teams, you know, with small, smart kids that play fast and they do it really well. And they would do that against just about anybody and any kind of athletes, you know. And so I don't think that's slowing it down. I think coaches oftentimes think of, they're bigger, faster, stronger, so we need to play slower tonight. And that is not necessarily the answer. We need to play a little bit different. There's subtle adjustments, but I don't think slower is always the answer, which I think a lot of people equate to being the answer.
I was talking with George Barber from Greenville, and he was, you know, talking about the style of play that they run, but then also the fact that he's been there for so long. And you're, to me, you're similar in the fact that I mean, you've had so much success at Emmanuel, and you've had championships. You've been there for a long time. You're known across the country as a great teacher of the game. Chad Sonji, who we both love, says you're one of the best coaches in the country. And with all of that, George Barber talked about making the big time where you are, and how he didn't really have these aspirations or dreams to move on like most coaches do when they have success. How have you been able to make Emmanuel the big time for you?
Yeah. Well, a couple things. I think part of it is how you're wired, right? Like, I'm not here to impress people. Like, I really want to do the Lord's work. And I've been coaching seventh and eighth grade girls, my daughter and her team. And I feel like I've been able to impact them as much as I've been able to impact my college guys. And I would say the same is true no matter where you're coaching. So let's just say that I have 12 seventh grade girls and I have 12 college players. Like, in my scheme, in what I would say the economy of what the Lord is thinking about, there's no difference between this 12 and that 12. Now, in the world, they're going to tell you, well, those 12 in the NBA are more important than those 12 eighth grade girls. I would actually argue the opposite of that. Like, those eighth grade girls are more important. Then they need more mentoring, more time, more, you know, of that than that player at 29, 30 years old might need. And so I think that's the first step, is coming to peace with, you know, who you are, why it's important to you, what your goal in coaching is. If you don't have peace with that, then you're always going to be a little bit antsy. Yeah. And so when people say, why have you stayed away? I don't know that I've, the things that might move me to another job, because I've had those job offers, just like I know George, and like that, that's the things that might move somebody else haven't moved me. Now, I can't say that 3 years from now, there's something that won't move me to that, but it's probably not going to be the same thing most coaches are being moved by. And so I think that really helps to have inner peace of why you're doing what you're doing, how you're doing. And then the second thing is really going to somewhere, making the big time where you're at. I would just say this, just stop complaining. Like, that would be my biggest thing. Like, when I came to Emmanuel, it was the worst facility in college basketball, hands down. We had almost no scholarship money. We have one of the, what people would say, the most worst locations. We're not in a city, we're in the country. Like, there's not much around where we're at. There's not like, so. But I did one thing. I just made peace with what I was about to do and said, I'm not going to make excuses. I'm just going to go give this my best effort. And I don't know if that means win 3 games or go on to win championships like we have. I don't know. But I wasn't going to let excuses and what I don't have and everything else get in the way of me pursuing greatness and me helping young people to pursue greatness. And so that was probably the biggest decision I made in my life, is to just say, because I went from a better job to the one I was going to. And I knew that, you know, like, I don't really know why. I mean, it was led by the Lord. I know why. But for most people, it's like, why are you going there? A lot of my friends are like, why are you going to that job?
I didn't know
that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, look, and along the way, there's been tons of lessons. I mean, I made $29,000 when I took the job, and I left one paying double that. And 2008 housing, you know, crunch came down. We lost the house. I mean, financially we were in trouble. There were so many. It was a really, really hard time in my life. But my decision when I went to Emmanuel to not make excuses for anything, but I'm just going to give this. It translated to, like, when that same thing happened and we lost our house. We had a house there when we moved, and we were trying to go. And times were really hard. We had 2 kids. We had bad insurance. Like, there was so many myriad of problems. My son spent a month in the hospital, you know, like, we all these things happened at one time. But I took the same attitude towards that. You know what? I don't know why, but I'm not going to make excuses. I'm just going to give this thing the best I got. I'm going to give this thing called life my best effort. And I think for coaches, that's just really important, that, you know, whatever it is that you're doing, first of all, you got to believe it's important. And I believe what I do is important, you know, and I believe what you do, Matt, is important. And I believe when I go coach these eighth grade girls, that's important. And so if you believe it's important, you're going to put everything you got into it. And then the second part of that, if you can just get rid of the complaints and excuses and just approach it every day with the best I got, because you don't know how long you got it. you're going to build something special because you're not worried about what everybody else is saying, thinking, and doing. You're just giving everything you got to that. And I think that the third part of that would be the last part is be like also committed to growing so I could give more. Like I want to get better as a coach every day so that I can give more. I recognize when I look back 15 years ago, like, man, I could have helped those 19, 20 year olds a lot better with the skills I got now. And I'm probably going to look back 10 years from now and think the same thing. But your ceiling is only as low as you let it be. But if you keep raising that ceiling, everything around you is going to have a chance to grow. And so you got to grow yourself. You got to spend time growing yourself.
I was thinking about the no excuses part or to take those out. I mean, I don't know if you feel this way, but we have discussions with coaches all the time. And I think pretty quick, you can find out the way that they feel about their school, their situation, just based on the things that they kind of, or you said no complaining, not excuses, no complaining, the things that they complain about.
Yeah,
it doesn't take very long. And I think it's, I love getting to listen to the coaches that, how was your year? Oh, man, just a joy to coach the guys. We overachieved. They gave me their best. I loved every second of it. I don't know. I think it's like you said, it's a decision of going into the year, choosing to think that way about your situation.
Yeah. And I mean, look, we can be the best complainers in the world. And, you know, I think about it like this, like the transfer portal right now, it's just crazy what it's doing in college basketball. I mean, it's insane. And, you know, I think it's a reflection of a lot of things, but is there ever a good time for a player to transfer? There is. Is there ever a good time for a coach to leave? There is. And I think one of those times is when you're bitter, when you're just unhappy, like it's making you worse, when you're stressed out, like just leave, go do something else. You know, like it's not bringing out the best version of yourself. Now that's it. But I think, you know, when you look at the transfer portal, there's some kids that need to do that. Like they're in a bad situation with a coach that's ruining their confidence, that they're just having a horrible time. You know, maybe it is time to leave. But then there's the other reality of it. There's a lot of kids out there that don't have it that bad, and they're about to leave a good situation for a worse one, and they don't know it. You know, and I think that's the same thing in coaches. Like we're not that much different. There's, man, this stinks. That's not bad. And you might, your next job might have a honeymoon period to it. But it might be worse than the job you just had. And, you know, and I think about this all the time. And I you know, I don't know where the quote originated. I know Graham has it hanging in his office. But, you know, while a lot of people are talking about how much greener the grass is over there, I'm sitting here watering my own grass. And I think that's important. Like we just got to water and things will flourish. We got to plant good seeds and things will grow. You know, like we just got to constantly do that and not worry about how fast it's growing, where it's growing. We just got to plant the seed and we got to water. We got to plant it and we got to water. And it'll come, it'll grow, it'll happen. But most times we don't know if we have the patience always to do that.
Yeah, that contentment that you're talking about, contentment has a negative, in the world, I feel like has a negative, you know, meaning or connotation to it where like lazy or complacent. But to me, and it's kind of what Paul talked about, it's being okay in plenty, being okay in not having a lot. And that part of that, with guys like, I mean, you and I that have faith, it helps. Yeah. But I was at church and a few weeks ago and in the, he was talking about contentment and he mentioned how maybe this is where God wants you to be. Meaning like, cause the thought is if you're not climbing, if you're not moving on, then there must be some deficiency in you. There must be something wrong in why others are moving up the ladder, how, why those guys are in college, those guys are in the NBA or right down the road at a big high school when I'm at this little high school. But he said, maybe, just maybe God has you exactly where you're supposed to be for that purpose and nothing else. Meaning you just got to maximize this time that you have with these players. That has been very freeing for me at a school where there's just this temptation at times of what if we had bigger, faster, stronger? What if we had six gyms like a school 5 minutes away does? But then that reminder of maybe God has me a grapevine faith for the long haul. And I just have to be faithful in that.
Yeah. And That is a hard thing to find in a society that's going the other way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I just had a first team All-American where, I mean, there's guys in the third team in our league taking mid-major offers right now. And so my guy, mid-major, power five, whatever, and he decides to stay. And I'm getting texts left and right from coaches. What an amazing job of recruiting. How did you keep him? What did you do? Like, it's, you know, 10 years ago, that wouldn't have been a question. Nowadays, it's like, if you keep a player, look, hey, a lot of credit to him. He's writing his own story. He's watering his own grass. What a fine young man. You know what I mean? Like, a lot of credit to him. Not credit to me. A lot of credit to him. But that's how much things have changed. And I think we get frustrated with kids that are doing that. But I think we live in a society where we all feel the pressure to do bigger, better, faster, more, you know, like all of those types of things. And, you know, we also know that there's warning against that. You know, Ecclesiastes, the king that had it all and realized he had nothing. Like, you go on down the list and, you know, you got to be careful. And I think just contentment.
Vanity, all vanity.
That's, yeah, right. Contentment is underrated.
Yeah.
You know, it really is. Now, complacent is probably one of those things you want to stay out of. Like, you don't want to be complacent. I'm not complacent at all. But contentment and thankful and gratitude for what you do have, I think those are important things.
Yeah, and I think too, it comes down to, what are we striving for every day? I love Remember the Titans, but I can't stand his message to the players of perfection, gentlemen, is what we're trying to attain. Excellence. You know, we can be at the places where we're at and strive for excellence every single day. Man, blown away. I was able to talk with Kevin Eastman, and he talked about when him and Doc Rivers took over the Celtics, how they just looked around at everything that they had and thought, how can I make this excellent? The way that we travel with the funds that we have, the way that we travel, is the locker room the nicest that we can make it? With the funds that, I mean, obviously their funds are different than you and I are talking about, but it made me think, even in our little locker room here at Faith, what can I go in there and do to make that a more of an excellent environment for my players? And maybe, you know, that, because I'm going to, high school is just no different now. They will leave easily. And so that's a good idea to continue to look for ways to build excellence with what we're doing.
And that's where complacently, like, you know, we're taking our team to Hawaii this year. We went 4 years ago, and people are like, oh my gosh, they must have all kinds. No, I got to raise $45,000 to take my team to Hawaii. But we're going to create a memory of a lifetime, a week that they will remember for the rest of their lives, the rest of their careers. Like, and so I don't have that reason. We don't have that as a school, as a resource. And I'm not saying you got to do something that big, but sometimes, you know, putting some wallpaper on the wall with a quote, you know, sometimes, yes, just getting them an
just
extra
paint, shirt, just do, like, a little, yeah, paint.
Just what can you do to start small? And I think about the things that I did 16 years ago when I came to Emmanuel to try and improve my program. And they seem like some of the dumbest, stupidest, wasteful things that you could have ever done, because that building was going to be condemned anyway. But I was committed to just making that, even though it's the worst facility, better than it was yesterday. Mm. And sometimes we underestimate those baby steps, those just little things, those little one percenters, and we don't realize. And sometimes it might not even have been the fresh coat of paint. It might have just been a player seeing that you care enough and you love it enough to go do something to improve your program. That was the thing that made the change.
Coaches, the Jamoti Podcast is powered by Shoot 360. The future of basketball has arrived in Dallas-Fort Worth. Shoot 360 combines the latest sports technology with the fundamentals of basketball skill development. The result is a one-of-a-kind video game-like basketball program designed to improve your shooting, dribbling, and passing. Visit shoot360dfw.com to learn more and register for your free one-hour workout evaluation. Shoot 360, the future of basketball is here. You haven't had a lot of defeat over the years, as far, I mean, obviously you've lost a few games, but with quite a few wins and some championships, I think one of the toughest things for coaches is to know or have the right idea of, or what does my team need now after a loss. So how do you go about handling defeat with your team?
Yeah, you know, you probably heard us say this before. I share this a lot, but like, self-awareness is a superpower. You know, like, just being aware of the like, where am I at? Like, sometimes you can sense where your team is at by the way you're reacting. Are you getting really tense? Are you getting really frustrated? Are you getting really, you know? And I think back to a couple of years ago, it was our first year D2. We were the smallest D2 in the country. And the first year we were able to compete, and I think people are like, oh, the NAI, they lost in the national championship. It's going to be different in D2. You're not going to get it. They're not going to understand. And, you know, we came out, we won the regular season championship. We ran the tournament championship, went to the NCAA tournament our first year of eligibility. Like, you know, just it was a really great run. But I think back to the one moment that probably changed it more than anything was a moment when we were losing. We lost like two or three in a row. And, you know, we're riding back on the bus and my assistants are like, we should practice in the morning. Like, they were frustrated. They were mad, right? They were going on, you know. And I said, you know what? We will meet in the morning. And we will meet at 6 a.m. in the morning. And I texted my assistants at night, and I texted them a list of stuff to bring. Some had to bring orange juice. Some had to bring a spatula. Some had to bring bowls or whatever. We had all the guys there, and the guys just thought it was gonna be the worst thing. And we cooked them just a phenomenal breakfast, best breakfast they've ever had. We cooked a huge breakfast for them, and we took time to apologize on how we were modeling leadership to them. That we believe serving others is super important. And what we recognized is that we've been asking a lot of you and demanding a lot of you, but we haven't been serving you in any way. So we just want to take time to apologize for not serving you and let you know how much you're appreciated and how much we love you. And so we just sat there, we ate breakfast that morning. Guys did not know what was going on. They were all eating. They thought we were whatever we were about to do that morning. We just spent some time together, whatever. And I mean, it was almost instantly, we just went on. I was like a 15 game win streak, or it was something crazy and insane like that. But I sensed that the loss was getting to me. I sensed the pressure was, you know, and I realized, gosh, you know, they were feeling it and they wanted, and you know, a lot of times we read losses the wrong way. Like, this kid didn't want it, or they, but they really, they're feeling bad themselves. They feel like they're not doing well enough. Like, there's so much that we can read into those. But I think many times, like, just reading the room and recognizing the heartbeat of the team, what do we need to do today? Do we need to play wiffle ball? You know, do we need to do whatever? Or do I need to step up the standards and the demands? Because, you know, we've got some players that aren't holding the line. Like, you never know what the answer is, but you can't quit searching, and you got to do your best to read the room. And I think it goes back to what we talked about in the beginning. Sometimes those little conversations with people, not always what you feel, but like, trust your gut and whatever, but also get a feel for what they feel. And direct questions might not always get it. What are you feeling right now? I'm fine. We're going to get this together. Why? Are we really? Like, what are you feeling? You know, is there tension? But I think a lot of times we don't spend time because we feel pressure to win. We stop spending time on the other stuff that will help us actually get the solution, our culture, our relationships, our leadership, stuff like that.
Dave Bliss never once cooked us breakfast in 3 years of playing for him. He did have some epic rants and pretty much just scary behaviors that he would show off. It'll work only to a certain point. Yeah. Where at some point you lose them, you lose the guys, and you can't, I mean, legally push them hard enough, you know, past a point. And so I think you're right on the money with being creative. And who'd you get that from? Or is that just something like being self-aware like you are, that you just thought that this would be cool?
I mean, heat of the moment, really. It was like, I think one of the things that I always try and do is look at me first. You know, like, I think a lot of times we try and fix the team and fix an attitude and fix a problem and whatever. Like, this is the team that I lead, and we're not in the direction or going the direction I want us to go. Like, I'm pointing the finger at myself first. And I think you just gotta, and in that moment, I realized, what do they probably feel for me right now? Mm. Well, I tell them I love them, but
that's a huge question.
So you find good solutions when you ask the right questions. And I think when you search internally first, you're going to find some solutions that I think you're going to be happy with.
I don't know how many coaches meetings that you've been a part of, and how many coaches you've helped over the year. The guys feel like they know you. I have a good relationship with you, but after the speed round, I'm just going to know you even better. You ready?
Oh, yeah. Go, baby.
Favorite ice cream flavor?
Chocolate chip.
For high school, shot clock or no shot clock?
Shot clock.
Favorite genre of music?
Ooh, Oh, man, I like them all, but man, throw in like a good like 80s, 90s, like AC/DC, Shook Me All Night
Nice.
Long. I'll get fired up, you
Let's
know?
go. Do you ever play that for your guys at practice or weight room time?
Yeah, and they got no idea what this is,
You
really.
know, you're right. They don't know what it is, but very few complaints. Well, I have an 80s playlist. Very few complaints on that day. I don't know. Just good stuff, I guess.
I need to do it more.
Texting or talking?
Texting, unfortunately. I'm telling the truth, though.
No, coach, it's speed round. You got favorite holiday.
Good Friday is my favorite holiday. If you consider that a holiday, but Good Friday is my
Sure.
favorite. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I know why, but I love that. Invisibility or super strength?
Ooh, invisibility. I'm an introvert, big time introvert.
You're a D, you know, but introvert. Is that a unique combination?
You know, I don't know. You know, it's funny that a lot of people that spend a lot of time speaking, which I do a lot of, are surprisingly really high introverts. You know, like Andy Stanley is a guy that I watch, the past, like just there's a lot, and I don't know what the correlation is, you know, to that. But you know, if I go out there and speak at a clinic or I do whatever, like I go to my room and crash. Like I got nothing left. And so yeah, but introvert,
If you could travel
invisibility.
back in time, what period would you go to? You can watch it. You don't have to be in it.
Go back and watch it. Playing high school basketball for my dad, you know, I miss him a lot, and I
Yeah.
think about all the lessons he taught me that I didn't even know he was teaching me. And if I could just go watch those lessons unfold, I think it'd be pretty cool.
Do you have a lot of similarities in the coach that you are and your style with your dad?
You know, he players would run through a wall for him because he put them first, and I'd like to think we're similar in that way. You know, I'd like to think that.
Three more. Favorite childhood TV show?
Oh, that's a close one between Fresh Prince of Bel-Air and Wonder Years.
Nice, nice. I would go with Saved by the Bell because
Good one.
Zach had the power of freezing time. Like he could pause time. We forget that he was a superhero.
If they didn't make the sequel, I might have gone there too. But
Yeah, college years ruined it.
yeah,
And then also, yeah, what two more. How many cups of coffee do you drink per day?
Zero.
Never been
Hey,
any
listen,
caffeine?
baby, you're either caffeinated or motivated. You're one or the other, and I've chosen to be motivated, baby.
Always, never been a big.
I will do a little pre-workout sometimes, Matt. I get some caffeine from that, but.
What's your favorite brand? As somebody that knows, I think almost every pre-workout, but
You know, and mine's probably not going to be one of the favorite, but this new one, the Alani, you know, it's like from, well, because I love Hawaii, like that's
okay.
they made it there, but they sell those power drinks now, but they also have a pre-workout and pretty good. But I just
Love
think
it.
maybe the picture on the label is makes me like it more than the actual product, but I don't know.
Last one, probably the most important that we've discussed all this whole talk. Godfather or Star Wars?
Oh, Godfather, easily. Now, all my kids, family, Star Wars, no doubt, but oh, the Godfather, you know, the whole thing through college, watched that multiple times. Like, that is Don Corleone.
Nice,
Yeah.
nice. Well, coach, this has been so much fun for me, and I'll just be honest with you, sitting on this call right here, there were times I forgot that we're doing a call. I was just, I don't know, just sucked in learning from you. And you do have that quality. I've always known it that just whenever you're teaching, man, like this is something that can really help me out. So just humbled, blown away that you'd give up your time like this. Thanks, man.
Yeah, and humbled that you'd have me, and that really heartfelt gratitude that you're out here serving coaches, because I just know how much coaches matter. And so when we're pouring into them in whatever way we're doing it, and you're doing it in a major way, you know, with your book, sharing your life, or through the podcast, man, like just appreciate you caring enough to care for coaches. So celebrate you for that.
Thanks, coach. If anybody would want to connect with you or kind of learn from, you know, some of the clinics or things or that you've done, what can they do?
Yeah, you know, at Coach TJ Rosine on Twitter is a good way to follow me. And, you know, I think, you know, if you get a chance, like PGC basketball is something I love. It impacted my life. It impacted your life in a big way. And I think it's really impactful for kids if they can go. I think it's also for coaches to attend session or to come to one of our coaching clinics. And I help run PGC coaching where we try and serve coaches. And check it out at PGC basketball, PGC coaching, and at Coach TJ Rosine. And if we could ever help in any way or help one of your players, well, we'd love to do that.
Also, I can't believe this is the first time I'm mentioning it, but you know, your work with the Hardwood Hustle is incredible. So if there is a basketball coach out there that doesn't know what the Hardwood Hustle is, and I don't mean to make you feel bad if you don't, but it's so great. And I've been a fan of it from the very beginning, but with PGC kind of stepping in and you and Sam, the dynamic that you guys have on that is so cool. And so golly, people should be listening and following you there too.
Yeah. Go start with the Matt Samen episode. Go pick that one. Start with that one.
Whatever. Coach, thank you so much, man.
Yeah. Appreciate you, Matt.
Thank you for checking out today's episode. Please take a moment to subscribe to this podcast, share it with your fellow coaches, and find us on social media for what's coming up next on the Jamoti Podcast. It's just a matter of doing it.